another edition of your Lakers Nation podcast. Jabari Davis back here with you, and I'm joined by Jamieson Welsh and Jordan Buscarini once again. We'll check in on the team's progress, and you know, now that they've experienced their first taste of success, or I guess regular season success together, we'll take a quick look at Kobe and how he can best benefit the team moving forward. We'll have a quick discussion about Jordan Clarkson's progression, and I'll ask these guys about his actual ceiling. Of course, we'll tackle this week's Lakers Nation Roundtable Question, as well as a Twitter question of the week. And I'm actually kind of excited because we'll be joined by, a good friend. He's the host of the Cruz Control Podcast, Mr. Randy Cruz. Not only will we get, his thoughts on how the Knicks are looking under Derek Fisher and Phil Jackson, but we'll also, sometimes it's good to get an outside perspective on our Lakers. Obviously we've got a packed show for you this week, so let's go ahead and jump right into it. Before we get into those topics, I actually wanted to quickly ask for your opinions on what I felt was just an excellent Kareem Abdul-Jabbar documentary. I don't know if you guys saw it this week or you had a chance to see it, already. For those listeners out there, I highly recommend it. It's, it was titled The Minority of One. It aired this past week on HBO. I'm pretty sure you can find it, moving forward. I thought it was excellent. I loved it, because not only did it honor just how great of a player and how much of a winner Abdul-Jabbar was for basically a stretch of, 25 years over his, from his high school days at Power, during his utterly dominant years at UCLA and, obviously, throughout his legendary career with both the Lakers and Bucks. I loved it because it also delved into a lot of his personal story and much of what went into kind of shaping his outlook and approach on life. Did you guys see it? And if so, what were your reactions to it?
I did see it. And one of the things that I was actually happy that he did get a documentary is Kareem has actually been a little bit more outgoing than in the past, like doing public appearances, and speaking to other people, making public speaking engagements and whatnot. So it was good to see a documentary on him because I always tell people he has the best basketball resume of all time. From high school, college, professional basketball, his resume, his body of work is the best of all time. There's no one that's ever played this game that has had a better resume than Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And I also got the chance to interview him last year when he was out here in Vegas for, I believe it was the Coaches versus Cancer, or one of the tournaments out here. And it was very interesting to see him being more and more acceptable by the media. People are more warm to speaking with him now. They're not intimidated. He's not standoffish. So it's really good to see him do these type of things. I hope it continues. But honestly, I think a lot of time we get the wrong impression on guys. We're too quick to judge certain players or certain people before we actually get to know them, and then we get these long, wrong conclusions about guys, but we don't even know who they are. So it's good to see Kareem in his own documentary, especially on HBO.
Yeah, it was definitely a very fascinating. I've actually watched this documentary twice. It was so fascinating. And I encourage anyone out there who knows Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, the basketball player, to really watch it. You're going to find a lot of interesting things in here, including his relationship with Bruce Lee, which is fascinating. Front to back, you'll see a little bit of a soured relationship with Wilt Chamberlain, which was a fantastic story in itself. You'll also get some commentary from Magic Johnson, Pat Riley, Elvin Hayes, Lucius Allen. I mean, you got some really great insight from some individuals. Larry Bird is another one, from some individuals that seen him as a teammate and also as an opponent. The thing that fascinates me so much about Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Jameson mentioned it, the most decorated player that we have ever seen. He's second to none. I mean, when you look at what this guy could accomplish. Also, when you talk about the basketball aspect of Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, he had the most unguardable shot ever. If you need one shot to win the game, there's no other player that I would choose other than Kareem because you know you're going to get a look. Yet Kareem took his education, and this is what I really got from the documentary. Kareem was able to take his education, especially in a time today where we see so many kids that are using college as stepping stone to get to professional dollars. Kareem is an example. He took his education so serious that the second part of his life after basketball, he's become a successful author. He's become an activist. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is a very educated man. And that's one thing, if I have to say, the one thing that I was a little bit disappointed out of the documentary, and again, I'm not saying I was disappointed, but the one thing that I would have liked to have seen a bit more is Kareem's life after basketball, because he has made an impact well beyond the hardwood. And this documentary was definitely enlightening in that form. So if you know Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, the basketball legend, please watch this because you're going to find out a lot more about Kareem beyond the court. And I think that's fantastic.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, again, you know, it's called Minority of One. It was on HBO. I'm sure you guys can find it. Absolutely recommended, you know, for the listeners out there. Okay, so let's go ahead and transition, you know, to the team. You know, as you know, they continue on this crazy stretch of the season, which has them on the road for what seems like an eternity, but it will end up being something like 15 of the next 19 away from the comfy confines of Staples. You know, anytime you have a young team, for any team, that's, you know, that's a kind of a brutal stretch, but especially for a young team that's really, you know, obviously still trying to figure it out. You know, but of course, it was very nice to see them kind of break the seal, you know, in terms of getting the win over the, you know, together over the Nets. We saw a lot of positives. You know, full disclosure, I was actually on the road during the game. I'm actually on location out here in Las Vegas in Jameson's neck of the woods, you know, for a family wedding. You know, so I watched the highlights. I got these guys run down, you know, like after the fact. But you know, I'm interested in getting your guys' opinion on it. You know, we saw a lot of positives from, you know, the usual suspects or guys that are becoming the usual suspects, and Jordan Clarkson and Julius Randle. You know, even though the narrative is a bit slow to change on D'Angelo Russell, I've personally been impressed with his play of late. You know, from the sounds of it, it sounds like he played well in that game. Give me your guys' assessment of what they look like. I know you said it was kind of an ugly game, but you know what they look like finally being able to, you know, have some success together out there in the regular season.
It was definitely rough on the eyes. Like, the game was definitely rough. Started off rough, but it was a W, and that's kind of what matters here. The one thing I liked is that there are different rotations, different guys played and whatnot. You saw Larry Nance Jr. get some minutes and get some productive minutes. He played well, provided energy and athleticism. That's something that the Lakers front court has been missing this season, because you have a lot of guys. I think most of the guys in the front court besides Hibbert are offensive guys. You know, also Tarik Black is a defensive guy as well, but the guys that have been playing have been offensive-minded guys, so the defense and the energy just hasn't been, you know, on that end, hasn't really been, you know, concentrated on. But also having Meta playing some minutes as well, that was it was key. I mean, even though we know Meta, we can't count him every game to be a great player and whatnot, he could still provide some energy on the defensive end, and it was good to see. I wish Anthony Brown would have got some minutes. I think he could also provide some energy on that end also. But you mentioned D'Angelo Russell earlier. You know, he didn't have any assists. He's gaining more confidence in his offensive game. I'm not sure what's going on between him and the coaching staff, because he made some comments after the game. But offensively, he seems more confident. He's seeming more confident in his game. He's seeming more confident and how he's being able to search for his own shot and actually take his own shot. Instead of thinking so much, it seems like he's doing more reacting. And that's a good thing. But like you mentioned, Jordan Clarkson and Julius Randle, they've been the two best players on this team thus far, and they've taken strides. Jordan Clarkson's a guy that has been very impressive. He's just a guy that really, every time we see him, he gets better. That's good to see. And also Julius Randle hit the nice 23-foot bank to pretty much put the game away yesterday. So it was pretty good win, pretty good game, but you want to see your young players that you're going to count on for the future. You want to see them close games out, and D'Angelo Russell should be on the floor when the game was on the line. You want him to gain that experience now. There's no need to have him on the bench watching other guys close out a game.
Jordan, to his point, how long before Russell earns the trust of the coaching staff in your eyes?
That's a very good question. I mean, last night he had a 10-point quarter. Jamieson talked about the offense getting rolling. You know, you are seeing some confidence from D'Angelo. You're looking to the bench. We didn't see Hurtis at all in this game against Brooklyn. So you wonder how much longer it's going to be before we get the key minutes for D'Angelo Russell. The problem is right now, and we've talked about this in the past, the way you want to use D'Angelo Russell. He may not have had a single assist last night, yet if you consider hockey, if a hockey assist is a stat, D'Angelo Russell was involved in several key plays last night, off ball and also making that first pass that would lead to a score. So D'Angelo Russell's offense is coming. As far as how long before we see him playing down the stretch, I really don't know, because 5 games into the regular season, and there's still some torques to the offense. Larry Nance Jr. at a world peace gets some time. Brandon Bass only plays 3.5 minutes, 4 minutes last night. So, there's still some torques going on. I think relatively soon, especially on a 5-game road trip, you're going to see D'Angelo Russell down the stretch. At least that would be my thought. However, you know, again, the confidence is building up. It's hard to really – we're 5 games deep into the regular season. 5 games deep into the regular season. So how long before D'Angelo Russell actually has a part in attempting to close out a game? I don't know, because you're relying on Lou Williams, who has been good. Jamieson mentioned that Jordan Clarkson and Julius Randle have been the two best players. Well, you know, Lou Williams has been one of the most consistent players on this team as well. So who do you put on the bench at this point in time? Yeah, you want your second overall pick to gain that experience. Yet I'm going to roll with the mindset that we're 5 games deep into the regular season, and it probably will happen. You have to rely more on depth when you go on a 5-game road trip. You have to rely on your bench a tad bit more, good teams and bad teams both. I mean, you have to dig deep on a 5-game road trip. So I expect that we'll see more of it. I don't know how long it's going to be before D'Angelo Russell is actually closing out a game. I just look for him to have more of a role in the next 4 games on the road.
Fair enough. You know, Jamieson, you mentioned that there were some comments after the game. Obviously, like I said, I'm on the road, so I didn't catch them. What were those comments? You know, what was it all about?
He was dissatisfied with not being in there after having, you know, after playing well, after playing better, what the coaching staff asked him to do, and he wasn't there to close out the game. And I understand where he's coming from. I mean, just probably so. If you improved your play and you're sitting on the bench in the closing minutes of a game, and yeah, he's kind of upset about that. So we'll see how that goes, you know, further. But also, you have to understand, this is a coaching staff that does things, you know, a little differently. They're old school mentality type of coaching staff. So they do, you know, Byron and the crew, they're going to do things a little bit differently. Whether it's the right thing to do is a different story, but they have their own ways of doing things. They come from a different generation. So they are used to saying, hey, you know what, rookies are better to learn, you know, maybe from the bench starting off, than actually learning on the fly. So we'll see how that goes going forward. But the key for D'Angelo is just playing well. Like, you know, the key for him is just keep on getting better and better each game. That's the key for him.
All right. On that note, we'll go ahead and transition to this week's roundtable question. You know, as always, brought to you by LakersNation.com and generated each week by Corey Hansford. But it centers around Coach Scott once again. Corey simply asked, you know, if we should expect Scott to last throughout the season, you know, given the difficult start. You know, I made my opinion about his role within the with the organization very clear over these past couple weeks. But to answer that question, I said that he's probably safe for this season, you know, unless, of course, the wheels just completely fall off the wagon and you start having more and more incidents on the bench or within the locker room and obviously, in the post game. So as you mentioned, Jameson, that'll definitely be a dynamic that is interested, you know, or that will be interesting to kind of monitor over the course of the season. But I also think it's kind of contingent upon him continuing to provide a space for this young nucleus to develop and progress, you know, as well as, you know, I understand his desire to win ball games, but I maintain his greatest measure of actual success for this organization at this particular time would be in making absolutely certain that this young core is as game ready as possible, regardless of how long he ultimately holds the position. What are your guys' thoughts on whether his tenure will last beyond what realistically looks like it's probably going to be Kobe's final run around the track?
It's very tough because, you know, as a coach, you're trying to win games. Like, you're trying to do what's best to win games. You're not thinking about the future. You're not thinking about 3 years down the line and getting guys experience. You're thinking about doing what's best to win games right now. So whatever you feel that is best, you're going to try to accomplish that. And it's a tough situation because, you know, Byron wants to do things that, oh, hey, he may want to try to win games. He may want to play some veteran guys. But at the end of the day, when it comes down to it, it's a rough situation because you have a lot of young guys that are really playing serious minutes for the first time in their lives in the NBA. So it's a really tough thing for him to juggle because, yes, he wants to win games as a coach, but also the best situation is really playing the young guys, giving them experience. I don't think if things get worse as the season goes on, I see them making a change in the middle of the season. But I do think, well, we'll see. I'll say we'll see on this team. I'm not having to decide on that. They need to improve. They need to get better. But it's tough as a coach because coaches always want to win. Coaches never sign up for tanking. They never sign up for development projects. They want to win and do whatever it takes to win. And to tell a coach that, you know what, we want you to play young guys and just go that route is very difficult for a coach to actually buy into that mentality 100%.
I will say this. I do believe Byron Scott's going to make it through the entire year, and this is why. Because, again, as we pointed out during several podcasts already this year, that wins and losses are arbitrary numbers. So you have to gauge Byron Scott's success this season on the growth of your young point guard, D'Angelo Russell, the growth of your forward, your stretch, whatever you want to refer to Julius Randle as, and his improvement, continuing to get the ball in the basket, several aspects of his game. You have to view Byron Scott's, the job that he has done on the growth of those young players. That's the bottom line right there. So if you're a guy, if you're in Mitch Kupchak's, if you're in his shoes, that's something that you definitely have to monitor. Jim Buss, same thing. You have to monitor the growth of your young guys. We've talked about Jordan Clarkson. What potential do you see in him as far as his ceiling? You have to make sure that these guys are taking steps in the right direction. The one thing that has Byron Scott as far as the saving grace goes, the fact that this team's not going to be competing for a playoff spot. You have a young group. Now, if you do, in fact, get rid of Byron Scott, you're going to be looking for a long-term replacement, somebody that can grow along with the nucleus that you have right now. So, with that being said, is it in the team's best interest to fire Byron Scott mid-season and bring in an interim coach only to bring in another head coach in the off-season because you're not going to find your long-term replacement middle season? It just doesn't work like that in the NBA. It's not going to happen. So is it in the best interest of a young group to essentially give them three coaches in a season and a half? No, that's not the best. That's not in anybody's best interest, much less a team that is looking to grow. You're essentially teaching three separate systems or three separate three separate philosophies within a year span. That's not good for any young player. So with that being said, I believe that Byron is safe this season as long as you're seeing growth, as long as D'Angelo Russell starts to pick up a more important role deep in games, as long as you're seeing Jordan Clarkson take that next step, as long as Julius Randle is continuing to improve, he's safe. It's just not good. It's not a good form for anyone to have three different philosophies within a year span. Any way you slice it or dice it. And again, it's unrealistic to think that you're going to find your long-term replacement midseason. Doesn't work that way in the NBA.
Fair enough. All right, good stuff on this week's roundtable question. As always, make sure you check out Corey Hansford's weekly roundtables on the site. They generally come out, I think, over the weekend or sometimes early in the week. And hopefully we'll be able to catch up with Corey and Trevor for next week's episode. But before we head into the break, I actually want to, and obviously, welcome Randy to the show. I actually want to go ahead and tackle this week's Twitter question or topic. As a reminder, we always appreciate your feedback and opinions on the show. On Twitter, I'm Jabari Davis NBA. Jamieson is @TheJamieson. Jordan is @Jordan_DTS. And remember, of course, to follow the official Lakers Nation profile, as well as all of the talented writers and personalities for great analysis, highlights, and insight on the game. But this week's topic is actually brought to you by @CoronaLimeDFS. This sounds like a guy for me. I don't necessarily know about the brand, but it sounds like a guy after my heart entirely. And what he said was, do you feel like Kobe will defer to the youngsters, kind of after some of the comments that he had made after following some of the earlier games where obviously he has been struggling? How do you guys feel about that dynamic and how it's been? I know his shot has been rough across the board, but what are your thoughts on how he's engaging with the young players and whether he's promoting their progress with his play beyond the positive feedback and words?
Well, that's the best role for him right now because, he's seen pretty much every situation imaginable in the NBA, and his knowledge can be more effective, being spread, to Randle, to Clarkson, and to D'Angelo Russell, and also Nance and Anthony Brown, more than his play can because he's seen and done everything on the court. He needs to be able to help these young guys out on a day-to-day basis because right now on the court, like I said last week, it's not healthy. It's not fully healthy. Whatever injury he suffered in preseason, I believe it's a calf injury, he's still trying to recover from that and still trying to play on a very old body. And it's showing. It's showing. He doesn't have the legs to get up on that jump shot as much as he'd like. So it's a very rough situation. But when you're not healthy, you're not fully healthy, you're not playing the best on the court, off the court, and also in timeouts and whatnot, you can still spread wisdom and coach up the young guys and get them ready because a lot of part of basketball is also the mental side, and that's the thing that gets overlooked a lot, especially with this young generation where everyone's in analytics and whatnot. But the mental side of the game and the actual, hey, let's think this out instead of just going out and play, it's a good thing to have a veteran like Kobe on the roster. It really is. But we'd also like to see some of the comments being played out to fruition. I understand you would like to, defer to those guys, but we got to actually see that on more than one game occasion. I think we can. I think we will, but I do need to see it first.
Yeah, as far as Kobe's role, the bottom line is he's going to be more useful, more effective from a leadership, more of a contagious work ethic standpoint than he is going to be out on the court. Even last night in the win against Brooklyn, Kobe, he missed his first six shots of the bowl game last night. He proved to be somewhat effective down the stretch. But yeah, Kobe is what he is at this point from a point, you know, from what we're going to get from him on the court. He's got to embrace that role. He's got to be the mentor role, you know, and I've seen reports that D'Angelo Russell continues to lean on Kobe. And it's great to see a young guy like D'Angelo Russell realize the situation that he is in, where he has one of the greats of all time, in the twilight of his career, but still he has one of the greats that he can learn from. And again, I believe that work ethic is one of the most important things that you're going to see, hopefully, rub off on somebody like D'Angelo Russell. So Kobe needs to defer. Is he going to? I don't know if it's in his mentality. I don't know if it's in. I don't know if it's if he has that chromosome. I really don't know. You know, when you're this successful for this long, it's easier said than done. And I think a lot of people have asked that question: why doesn't Kobe embrace the fact that he's not the player that he once was? Well, it's tough to say because I've never been a 17-time All-Star that has won multiple championships and is one of the greatest to ever play the game, and now you're asking him to step back on a team that is not very good, a team that's going to be pressing 25 wins. It's tough to do. I'm sure it's extremely tough to do. You got to go back to the last time that the Lakers were rebuilding. Kobe single-handedly took over games and put this team in a position to where they were at least, you know, they were a playoff team. They'd won, you know, they were the seventh seed going up against Phoenix the year before. The year that they missed out on the playoffs, they were so close. If it wasn't for a Kobe injury, they may have made the playoffs that season. So, yeah, it's a different role for Kobe, and it's hard for somebody in his situation to just take a step back. Hopefully, he's matured enough to where he can embrace that role. I don't know. I'm not in the locker room. I haven't been in the Laker locker room yet this season. All I have is reports and hearsay, but it seems without doubt that he is going to be more effective from a leadership standpoint than he is going to be on the court this season.
Yeah. I agree with each of you on that. You know, I kind of look at it like, yes, we would all like, you know, love, you know, for Kobe to turn into Professor Kobe and this, that, and the other. Look, a Tiger's not going to lose his stripe, and a 20-year-old Tiger's definitely not going to lose his stripes. That said, I mentioned that because, you know, to a certain degree, you know, Kobe's going to be who Kobe is, but I have seen positives. You know, like I have seen, and as Jameson mentioned, you know, the relationship with D'Angelo Russell is pivotal. You know, obviously you want to see him, you know, his work ethic, you know, rub off on all of those young players. But if D'Angelo Russell is going to be the a leader on this team, and obviously the guy with the ball in his hands, the orchestrator of, you know, of the offense and of the team in general, then you know, I couldn't see a better, you know, role model in terms of as Jameson mentioned, you know, from a work and an approach perspective. In terms of Kobe, I mean, you know, again, I don't think it's realistic to expect him to just completely flip the scripts, but as long as it stays a positive, you know, as long as they have a positive relationship, I think it's fine. And ultimately, you know, it's kind of going to be what it is. You know, again, this is probably going to be his last lap around the track. So, hopefully he doesn't stumble and fall, you know, along the way too many times. All right, let's go ahead and head into a quick break. But when we come back, you know, again, we'll be pleased to be joined by the host of the Cruz Control podcast, Randy Cruz, as we get his take on the Knicks, their future, what they look like under Derek Fisher and Phil Jackson at this stage, and also, again, to get an outside world to say in about the Lakers. So stick with us here on your Lakers Nation podcast.
The Lakers Nation podcast will be our weekly discussion where we provide analysis on the team, a behind-the-scenes look from both practice as well as the games, and we attempt to be the voice of Lakers Nation, which we all know is the greatest fan base in professional sports. So stick with us each week.
This is Tarik Black, and you're listening to Lakers Nation podcast.
Welcome back to your Lakers Nation podcast. Jabari Davis, Jamieson Welsh, and Jordan Buscarini back here with you. And as I mentioned before the break, we're now joined by the host of the Cruz Control podcast, Mr. Randy Cruz. Randy, thanks a lot for joining us this week.
No problem, man. Anytime. Looking forward to it.
No, absolutely, absolutely. All right, so for anybody that, you know, that is catch the accent, obviously, Randy is based out of the East Coast, New York. You know, where exactly in New York are you based out of?
I live on the Upper East Side of Manhattan.
Oh, okay. I'm trying to be like you one day. Trying to be like you.
Yo, no, man, you're in LA with 75 degree weather and like, or whatever in November. It's like 50 over here, so I'm more jealous of you, man.
Nah, keep it real. You know I love the West Coast. So yeah, if I were to go to the East Coast, I would try to be like you. But I'm definitely not gonna complain. I'm wearing flip flops right now. All right.
Here we go.
Hey, my bad. For anybody that's not familiar with Randy, you know, great stuff. You know, what's your Twitter handle? Where can they follow you on Twitter?
Randy J. Cruz.
Great stuff. You know, again, you know, follow him on Twitter. You know, if you do that sort of thing, check out his Cruz Control podcast. I've been a guest a couple of times, and you know, fortunate enough to be a guest a couple of times. And he always, you know, great insight, you know, and just overall general, you know, about NBA opinions. In particular, we're going to come to him and talk about the Knicks. You know, that's his passion or one of his passions. Talk to me about, you know, life as a Knicks fan, you know, with Derek Fisher and Phil Jackson, I guess in years 2 and 2.5 for each of them.
Well, you know, just to break it down real quick, I've been a Knicks fan since 99. It's been a long 16 years. I had a few playoff runs here and there during my tenure as a fan. It's been mostly upsetting because you want to see this team do well and go far in the playoffs. And like I said, we've only been to the playoffs, I think, six times since I've been a fan. And, you know, with Derek Fisher being on board, and, you know, we missed out on Steve Kerr last year, so I'm still very upset about that. But, I mean, this year is like the true coaching year one for Derek Fisher. Last year was just a mess, man. A lot of different starting lineups. People got hurt. Melo missed like 40 games. So a lot of Knicks fans here on this side were really looking forward to what Derek Fisher is going to bring to the table with a much improved roster than last year. They got Robin Lopez and Aflalo. They drafted Jerry and Grant in the Tim Hardaway trade. Melo was back healthy. And, of course, Porzingis at number four. So There was a lot of upside coming into the season. Right now, they're 2-5, if I'm not mistaken. But all seems to be positive when it comes to me, because I don't think they're going to win less than 17 games like last year. I think they're going to win more. I think when it comes to a fan, we have to think realistically whether, A, are they going to win more than 17 in the 30 or 35 range, show improvement, but still miss the playoffs? Or do we have a good enough roster to try to fight for the eighth spot?
That's fair enough. Well, what about the, you know, how are fans feeling about the current direction of the team? You know, in particular, what about the job that Phil Jackson has been doing as the GM or president of the organization?
I think some fans are still a little optimistic on Phil. You know, this summer he had a chance to prove to everybody of his clout and who would be willing to take an interview with him as far as the free agents went. Like I said, we got Lopez and Aflalo. It wasn't – we did not get the big-time names that we were looking for or that were out there, like Aldridge and DeAndre Jordan. We didn't even get a meeting with Aldridge, so that kind of explains a lot. But I think for what he was able to do with the money he had, getting some good, valuable role-player pieces – and then hopefully come up big next summer, the whole thing with Kevin Durant being a free agent. We have no idea where he's going to go, whether he's going to stay in OKC. New York is a prime destination, I think, for him. So if he were to strike out this summer, play it cool, and then somehow get Kevin Durant next year, everybody would be up in arms just praising him. But I think he did a decent job this summer getting some pieces to go around Carmelo, because last year's team was just a debacle over here. And like I said, 17 games was the worst in the team history. So I still have room for improvement for him, because we don't know if the team is going to remain the same come the trade deadline. So let's see what he can and cannot do and pieces that he would want to move come February. So like I said, they're 2-5. He's doing an okay job, in my opinion. But I think this summer when Kevin Durant becomes a free agent, if you don't get him or if he's not even in the running of coming here, then I really don't know what to expect, because I think we're in the second year of his five-year contract. I could be wrong. I think it's year two. So, you know, if we strike out big, you know, in the first 2 years, then I don't know what to expect in the final three.
Again, we're talking to Randy Cruz of the Cruz Control Podcast. You know, we appreciate you taking the time this morning again with us. Okay, you know, so let's talk about the Carmelo Anthony angle of it all. You know, out here, you know, folks know it was, you know, reported, of course, you know, widely that the Lakers went after him. You know, when he was up for free agency last or two summers ago. Obviously, you know, he didn't end up taking the contract. He ended up taking the money and staying home. You know, with your Knicks. I got in a little bit of trouble. And when I say trouble, I had got a little bit of a flack last season because I was asked, what direction they should go. And I actually mentioned that, you know, even though I understand, you know, everybody, you know, the fans there love Melo. I kind of recommended that they look to move him and kind of press an entire reset button. Clearly they didn't go that direction. And obviously I think fans are probably happy that they didn't. But talk to me about the dynamics with Melo, you know, moving forward. And actually let's bring up Kristaps Porzingis. You know, fans out here of the Lakers can understand, you know, a bit of scrutiny around a high pick with D'Angelo Russell, who has, you know, clearly been improving over the last few games. But talk to me about Porzingis. What does he look like now? You know, now that we don't have to simply go by YouTube video or, you know, highlight packages, what's he looking like? You know, what does he actually, pan out to be at this level, in your opinion?
Well, it's funny because when the draft happened in June and they drafted Porzingis, me and a lot of Knicks fans, you know, on the Twitter, social media, was like, who is this? Why you draft him? We lost 17 games for some guy we don't know that we have to look up on YouTube, and why don't you get someone like a Justice Winslow or Stein or somebody like that? I'm not too sure if I was a fan or not at the time, but it was like, listen, if this guy's going to go at number four and Phil Jackson took his time and the whole team took their time to really research what he can and cannot do, if he goes number four, he has to be somewhat good. He can't be any less than that. So in the first seven games, I think on this side, he's been shocking a lot of people. He's been playing it well against veterans like Tim Duncan and Kevin Love. He's brought some excitement back to the Garden. I like the fact that Melo wants to be a big brother type mentor to Porzingis and not have all the pressure be on him, because being the number four pick, especially here in New York, can be a big time pressure moment for you. So Melo taking the load off of him and just kind of you know, taking his back is really good, and Porzingis has been playing well to my knowledge, and the fact that if he stays out of foul trouble, he'll go a long way in the league. But to your point about Melo staying, the whole LA thing, New York, I never knew. I mean, I never thought Melo was going to leave anyway. You know, interviews over here, he said that he wanted to retire a Knick. I believe him. A lot of fans believe him. And to, you know, force your way out of Denver to come to New York to say, hey, listen, I'm going to go to L.A. or Chicago, and that's it, would not have looked right on his image. And people could say, well, he stayed because of the money. There's no upside for the team. They're not winning a championship anytime soon. So there was a little knock on him. But I think that he will remain a Knick. He will retire a Knick. Hopefully, you know, just me crazy thinking, he'll get far in the playoffs to compete for a championship. I think they're a few years out of that. But everybody seems to be a big fan of Melo, of him staying, and him being 31, still in the prime of his career. Now we're questioning, how many years do you have left with the current roster you have, and how many times can you go into a season and just say, well, it's still rebuilding, or we got to wait till next year? Like, I don't think he has that much time left being a prime player. So hopefully this season and next year they can really get things going.
Absolutely. I mean, of course, you want to be able to capitalize on the you know, I don't want to say the final great years, but on his peak as a player. Okay, so before we get you out of here, I've got to get your opinion on our Lakers. You know, your fans are going to be like, "Well, what the hell do we care about? What do we care about?" It's always good to get an outsider's perspective. You know, right. Sometimes, you know, as a fan, you're a little bit too close to the situation. So from the outside looking in, I'm trying to shape this so I'm not, you know, technically shaping your answer. What, you know, what are your thoughts on the young core? You know, obviously of, you know, Julius Randle, you know, in his second year, which obviously his first year on the court, you know, Jordan Clarkson in his second year, looking, you know, looking strong. And then, you know, in particular, I want to get your thoughts on D'Angelo Russell's progress so far.
Well, first of all, congrats on your first win against Brooklyn last night.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that. You know, they broke the seal. I think we mentioned that earlier.
Exactly. I like the young core with Russell, Randle coming back from injury, Clarkson. The fact that they still have Kobe in the roster and Meta World Peace still in the roster and Byron Scott coaching, to me, honestly, I don't think the total rebuilding is going to start or be on its way unless Kobe retires, Byron Scott is out the way, and just the older veterans not being on the rise. I say that because the fact that these guys need to play in crunch time, these guys need to get that experience to compete in a very tough Western Conference. And the fact that Kobe, man, I'm a big Kobe fan. I watch just about every Laker game just because he's on the roster. And it seems like I put the analogy like this. I don't want him playing too long where it's like we're all saying, Kobe, we appreciate what you've done for the league and everything, but it's that time to go. Like, I don't want him to be like that old pro wrestler who doesn't want to hang up the boots or takes his time to hang up the boots, like a Ric Flair or Hulk Hogan kind of guy. So it's like, Kobe, man, it's that time to hang it up. I know what you're trying to do, but if you want to be the big mentor kind of guy or that veteran leadership to Russell now, who's, you know, that team is going to belong to him and Randle as early as next year, then Kobe can do that. But Kobe trying to get 20, 25 minutes and take the last shot kind of guy, the Black Mamba, he don't have to do that no more. I think a lot of people feel like this is his final season. He's not very big on the whole farewell tour and just all this, you know, nostalgic stuff. And I think he wants to go out in his own way. I don't know. I mean, it's going to be up to him. Only Kobe Bryant knows when it's going to be his final regular season. Everybody questions him. Even last night in Brooklyn, they were questioning him and how far this is going to go. But I think once he retires, a lot of pressure is going to be on the young guys to take over his role. And, you know, nobody can do that. But I like when you guys drafted Russell. I don't know what kind of feedback you they got when they pick Russell over Okafor, but for the Lakers and Showtime and that kind of environment, I like Russell. I think he has a very high upside, and I'm a big fan of Randle. He reminds me of a very younger Zach Randolph. He's not Z-Bo yet, but he can potentially be that kind of guy. And Clarkson has improved vastly, you know, averaging, 16, 17 points a game. And I mean, the upside is there. Maybe you're about 2-3 years away from that. But only things can get better for your Lakers.
I definitely appreciate that feedback. You know, just to quickly touch on what you just shared. Yeah, it was never going to be pretty for Bean, you know, down the stretch for Bean. I mean, anybody that's kind of followed his career, we kind of knew that. Obviously, you'd like to see the transition be a little bit smoother, and hopefully over the course of this season, whether it's his last season or not, which I do personally, you know, as I mentioned to you on your show over the summer, I do think it's going to end up being. But ultimately, you just hope, you know, like I said, for a smooth transition. I agree 100% with you in terms of the team, you know, probably being, you know, still another, you know, year or two, you know, maybe even three away from being, you know, that elite level, but they are clearly like on their way. And I, you know, you just bring an excellent point that, you know, it's a difficult one to, you know, for some people to hear. It's even more difficult for, you know, some folks to say, but until they are able to fully just press reset, right, you know, some of the progress and some of what, you know, we would like to see and what we'll eventually see is just going to kind of be on hold. You know, again, fantastic stuff. I appreciate you joining us today. Can you let the folks know once again where they can find you on Twitter? If you've got any exciting shows coming up, and you know, what have you got for the people?
Well, first of all, thank you for allowing me to come on the podcast. I always follow what Lakers Nation do on social media. I've been a big fan of yours for quite a while, and man, this is the first time I've been on your show, and you're always more than welcome to come back on mine, so thank you for that. People can follow me on Twitter at Randy J. Cruz, RandyJCruz. They can find my podcast, Cruz Control, on iTunes, SoundCloud, TuneIn, Blog Talk Radio. I don't know who I have coming up yet, but I think that's the beauty of this podcast industry where, you know, any given day you could just pop up with a guest in the show. So I don't know who I'm having coming up, but they can recap shows that I've had with Kenny Anderson and Marbury and Jason Kidd, all down the line for the last couple of years. So a lot of great content. If you're a basketball fan, if you're a pop culture fan, you can touch up on that too. So, again, I thank you, Jabari, for allowing me to come on the podcast, and I hope Knicks Nation don't get mad at me for coming on a Lakers Nation podcast and feel like I'm a traitor or something, but it's not like that. I'm just a basketball fan and a big-time Kobe fan, and hopefully both our teams, you know, get to that level once again in the near future, man.
You know, it's funny that you mentioned that, and of course, you know, hopefully that is the case. As a fan of the overall sport, obviously, I grew up here in Los Angeles, and you know, I've been watching these Lakers for the past, you know, really, ooh, I hate to say it, but 30 plus years. You know, but as a fan of the overall game, I think it is better when the Knicks are relevant, when the Lakers are relevant, when, diversity is great. You know, like, you know, having, you know, teams in small markets win, that is absolutely fantastic. And I'm glad to see that. But I also think the big markets, it's a good thing. It's, you know, in terms of the overall, you know, NBA storyline, when there's some relevancy there. So again, thank you so much for joining. You know, really appreciate it. And we'll definitely have to catch up with you. I think the Lakers play the Knicks again. In the new year, you know, we'll try to catch up with you again, you know, around that time if you have the time.
You know, it's crazy. Me and you are going to battle for Kevin Durant this summer. So if Kevin Durant is a Laker, I may not talk to you for a hot minute.
Well, you know what? I'll put it to you like this. I'm not going to hold my breath, but I do hope that, I do hope the Lakers are in the mix. You know, I think that's a long way away. You know, we'll see, you know, how each of our teams, you know, continue to develop and progress, and, you know, obviously see how OKC does. But if he hits the open market, yeah, you're exactly right. We all going to be battling for him.
Hey, man.
All right, Randy, thanks.
It's a be seen.
No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No,
we'll
just remains to be seen where he goes, man. Should be very interesting this summer.
For sure. All right, folks. Again, you know, tune in to the Cruz Control podcast. That was Randy Cruz. We appreciate him taking the time to join us again. You know, his Knicks, you know, they look like they're on the rise again. Our Lakers, obviously, you know, we're in a transition period and continuing to rise, but we definitely appreciate him taking the time, and it's always good to catch up with him. So, follow him on Twitter, check out his stuff.
Thank you, man. I appreciate it.
All right, great stuff for sure with Randy. Appreciate the fact that he joined us. And, of course, we'll try to check back in with him at some point over the course of the season, maybe the next time the Lakers play the Knicks. But before we run out of time, let me go ahead and get some final shots from each of you guys. Jamieson, why don't you lead us off?
Final shot is this. No matter how the season goes, good, bad, or indifferent, you want to keep your spirits up, and you want to look at the positives of the season. You want to see the young guys play well. You want to look at the positives. You don't want to get too down yourself on the team and whatnot, because it doesn't help the situation. So you always want to keep positive thoughts. You always want to think positive out of things. And you also want to hope that the young guys are playing more. You want to see Anthony Brown and Larry Nance play more. You want to, especially on this road trip, the road gets 16 out of 20, or I guess, sorry, 15 out of 19 left on the road. Hopefully we see a lot more guys on the road playing play a lot more games and, you know, getting to know this team a little bit. Because remember, there's a lot of young guys on the team that we really don't know about. But we want to stay positive and, you know, give guys a chance. Because there's going to be a lot of ups and downs. But, be patient with this young group, because I think we're going to see some flashes. I think we've already seen some flashes in this short amount of time. So just be patient and just enjoy the show.
Yeah, I think Jameson hits it right on the head, honestly. There have been some positives. I know a 1-4 start isn't exactly fantastic. Here's a tidbit for you. That Brooklyn Lakers game, it was only the ninth time in NBA history that two winless teams after four or more games, have played each other. So when you talk about the quality of basketball, I think you see two teams that, when you look at it on paper, we've seen another rookie last night, and Alonde Hollis Jefferson, who actually came out now, I believe he had 11 rebounds, if I remember, in that game. So without talking too much about the Brooklyn Nets, you've seen a couple of teams that have some interesting players that are going to be fun to watch for the next couple of seasons. It's a struggle. Sometimes, though, if you look a little bit deeper, you can see beauty in the struggle. Again, you got to go back to the last time the Lakers were in a rebuilding phase. One trade actually changed their fortune, and before you know it, they were competing for an NBA championship against Boston. So it's a beautiful struggle if you look deep enough. Hopefully in 2 to 3 years we can look back without getting too cliche and too cheesy and say, you know what, all the growing pains were well worth it. This is a group that does have some exciting players. Nonetheless, I did get a little nostalgic last night watching Metta World Peace come back out, wearing number 37, knocking down what turned out to be a fairly important three-point shot, and he also had a big defensive play late in the game as well. So, maybe you can get a little bit of nostalgia out of this team and still watch some growth from guys like Clarkson, Russell, and Randall. And really, coming off of a 21-win season, that's going to be one of the positives that hopefully we can hang our hats on, growth.
Absolutely, and mine will be quick because I'm just piggybacking what you guys are saying. Basically, enjoy the process, enjoy the progress over the course of the season, and try not to get caught up on the results of every single game. That's a death sentence for any fan out there. So, I know folks don't want to hear patience, but that's really what it's going to be about. It's going to be about what the final product looks like, not necessarily what it looks like along the way. These young guys have talent, they can play, and they should ultimately be successful at this level, but it's just, like I said, I think on one of the very first episodes, it's not going to be a push-button rebuild. You're going to have to take some lumps along the way. So for each of these guys, again, we appreciate Randy joining us, Randy Cruz, the host of the Cruz Control Podcast. Again, remember to follow him on Twitter, for all of his great stuff, and again, for each of these gentlemen, for Jamieson Welsh and Jordan Buscarini, I am Jabari Davis, and this has been your Lakers Nation Podcast. We appreciate you taking the time to listen, and we hope to have you again next week.
You know it ain't no stopping all the dogs I'm dropping. It's Friday night, so everything is popping. I got skin to spin on the hand, so let the games begin. Yakety yak.